Yes, my name is Frank Thomsen. I've been working for DHI since 5.5 years, and I've been working in marine environmental research since approximately 26 years. But first of all, we have to recognize that water is an ideal medium for sound transmission because it's much more effective than air. Sound travels underwater 4 times faster than air. So consequently, sound ranges can be very, very large underwater. And marine life has adapted really well to this. They produce all kinds of different sounds to communicate, to forage, and to navigate with one another. For example, dolphins communicate over many kilometers underwater. Fish communicate underwater with sound. And even invertebrates seem to use sound. And human sound, for example, from an offshore wind farm or an offshore seismic survey, can interfere with all these functions. Well, they can react in many ways. First of all, sound can actually mask their own signals, so they can't hear one another very well, so they cannot find one another again, because many of the sounds are contact calls. Then, of course, they can react behaviorally, very subtle behavioral reactions like wigging with the tail, but also a very drastic reaction can occur by outright avoidance of larger areas. So behavioral reactions are possible, and then there can also be hearing loss due to sound exposure. Well, the first really important measure is actually to assess the impacts using a risk-based approach. In some cases where there is actually no marine life present, industry can produce a lot of sounds and not affecting any marine life. But of course, there can be situations where there's very important habitat for the animals, where industry then produces sound which can have adverse consequences. And in this case, industry has to do something about sound. They can try to minimize the sound at the source by being a little bit more quieter, by dampening the sound, for example, putting cups on wooden caps on pile driving to reduce the sound levels. There can be also measures to reduce the sound that is coming out of an operation, for example, again, offshore wind farm pile driving. There can be bubble curtains, these are air bubbles around the pile driving activity, and the sound there is reflected totally and reduced so that marine life is not really affected. So there are varieties of measures industry can take to reduce the impacts. Well, industries in Europe have to follow an environmental impact assessment, which is basically the risk-based approach. They have to assess the impacts based on internationally accepted criteria. In some cases, they have to do some modeling of the underwater sound. And then if they find that there is a big or huge impact, they have to do something about it by minimizing the sound exposure, not to affect marine life. Well, outside of Europe, it's, for example, in the US, there's a Marine Mammal Protection Act that's very similar to what industry has to do in Europe. And beyond that, in some cases, there's very little regulation. And this is why international bodies such as the UN are very important to advising on regulations and frameworks to assessing impacts to actually save marine life across the planet. Well, of course, I would advise them to use the adequate framework. The risk-based approach that I have mentioned previously is really the best approach to assess impact, so they should adhere to that. And they should also think that the investments they do today in order to minimize impacts are actually investments in the future, because we all rely on the marine life to be well. Well, the industries face challenges in terms of costs, increased costs. And bubble curtain for an offshore wind farm is, of course, very cost extensive. And also reducing survey time for a seismic survey can actually prolong a seismic survey and, of course, lead to increased costs. So the industry is facing the problem in the marine with increasing costs due to these mitigation measures. But again, these are investments in marine life, and industry should have an interest in actually protecting marine life. Well, that's a very good question. We found that fish that are exposed to pie driving sound in very, very large net pens, 40 meter diameter net pens in a Scottish bay, where we played back the sound through an underwater speaker, react by speeding up. They were swimming much faster. So we actually could show that at these sound levels that were comparable to very large ranges in the field, fish actually would react to pie driving with negative behavior response. Back during my PhD days, I found actually that killer whales that have dialects, group-specific dialects, family-specific dialects in their communication, have a second kind of language which they all share and which is also learned. So that was a very unique discovery. Well, I think if I can mention my field, I think it's the increase of ambient background sound due to increase of shipping and other more continuous sources. They change the acoustic habitats for marine life. Not so much the impulsive sounds that maybe can act over very long distances, but this ambient sound increase changes the acoustic habitat. That means the area over which the animals communicate with one another. And this can be long-term changes to their acoustic environment, which I'm really concerned about. I think it's very important that we cooperate with industry also on research projects. We have initiated one research project together with industry where we look actually at the movements of whales and dolphins and also fish in response to underwater sound using agent-based models. This is a very, very new technology, and we are very proud that we could work together with one very important industry partner on actually developing this field of science further for better risk assessment. Well, I guess I have been always interested in marine life and in animals in general, and I was particularly fascinated by whales. So as a topic for my diploma thesis, I choose to study whales in Canadian waters, paddling with them with a kayak. And this led to a lot of really interesting experience with the animals, and also my long-lasting fascination with the underwater world, and especially with underwater sound.